This actually happened twice. Both times times were after she had gone through incredibly bad breakups with her on-again, off-again boyfriend, John. So, she's going through a really rough time. Then, just as spring break was approaching, a group of seniors asked Brittanie if she wanted to go down to Myrtle Beach for spring break with them. While it was pretty common for seniors to go down to Myrtle Beach for spring break, juniors typically were not invited. So this was a big deal for Brittanie to be invited to go down with the older kids. And she really wanted to go, but her parents would not let her. Her mother, Dawn, felt like Brittanie wasn't old enough to take this super long road trip clear down to Myrtle Beach and then stay there for several days with no parents supervising them. Plus, her parents didn't want to reward her behavior with a trip. But Brittanie, like most teens, just wouldn't accept her mother's refusal on the issue. And her dad also agreed he did not want her going down there, but she just keeps pestering her mother, and it becomes this huge fight that they're constantly having. The school's spring break started on April 20th, and April 22nd was the day that all of her older friends were going to go down to the beach, and Brittanie is just relentlessly pestering her mom this morning, and her mom doesn't change her mind, and Brittanie gets so mad that she packs a bag, storms out of her house. She calls her boyfriend and asks him to come pick her up, and he does, and he takes her over to another one of her friend's houses. Brittanie gets to this friend's house. She calls her mom, and she apologizes for, yelling at her and storming out of the house. And again, she asks her mom if she can please just go to Myrtle Beach. And Dawn says, absolutely not. At no point says that Brittanie is down in Myrtle Beach, and no one can get a hold of her, and no one has seen her. She has completely stopped responding to his texts over an hour ago. He felt like something was really wrong right away because they had been texting back and forth, and all of a sudden, it just like abruptly stopped. And after like 10 minutes, he was like, "Brittanie, you are scaring me. If you don't text me back, I'm gonna call your mom, and I'm gonna tell her where you really are." And 30 minutes go by, and Brittanie doesn't respond. This point, she had to be in trouble because she was slightly terrified of her parents finding out she had gone to Myrtle Beach without their permission. Dawn doesn't even really know what to do with this information, but her heart has just dropped right into her stomach. She hangs up the phone with Dawn and calls Chad, her soon-to-be ex-husband, and then she begins trying to call Brittanie over and over and over, but Brittanie isn't answering. John, who had been at work when he made this initial call to Brittanie's mom, leaves work and rushes over to the Drexel house, and that's where he tells Dawn everything. According to him, Brittanie was ready to come home from Myrtle Beach early. Without her friends. See, she had gone down there with these older friends. Everyone was hanging out, having a good time. All just like relaxation and fun in the sun with her friends. But by the second day, her friends really started partying hard. They were experimenting with different drugs. And Brittanie really wasn't into that scene, so they kind of started leaving Brittanie out. So basically, Brittanie ended up being just alone, which being alone in Myrtle Beach during spring break, this really made Brittanie an easy target. So after Brittanie's mom finds out that she's down there, she's alone, and she's missing, she calls local police, but the Rochester Police Department, they have no jurisdiction in Myrtle Beach. They can't do anything about a missing teen 14 hours away. So Dawn had a family friend that lived in North Carolina, so she calls her friend, and her friend ends up going to the Myrtle Beach police station to report Brittanie missing. Chad and Dawn are up all night long trying to figure out a plan to find Brittanie. And early the next morning, Dawn, John, Brittanie's boyfriend, and her father Chad and a small group of friends drive down to Myrtle Beach. In the meantime, police are busy launching an investigation to try and locate the missing teen. Now, initially, they're thinking she just ran away. She had been fighting with her parents. She very defiantly went somewhere they told her she couldn't, and they truly did not expect foul play. They kind of expected Brittanie Two hotels. sunglasses also didn't look like they had been out, like exposed to the elements, for 8 months. There wasn't like dirt caked on them or anything like that. Please take these sunglasses as evidence, hoping they can get some information for them, but if they don't, not a single trace of DNA was found on them. No, like, DNA profiles, nothing. And because of the condition of these sunglasses, a lot of people believe someone went and put them there and then called police and gave them a tip to kind of throw them off the scent of the real place where Brittanie was. The fact that no DNA was found on them also pointed to the glasses either being placed in the area by someone who had like wiped them off, or someone who was wearing gloves. Then in April of 2010, police announced that they have several persons of interest, although they didn't release any names and no arrests were ever made. Even Brittanie's parents weren't given information about who these persons of interest were. Several different law enforcement agencies were working on the case, but no one could really piece together what had happened to Brittanie. In 2012, a sex offender from South Carolina named Raymond Moody is named as a new person of interest. Police were never able to gather enough information to actually link him to Brittanie's disappearance. And again, no arrest was made. On June 8th, 2016, the FBI confirms that Brittanie is deceased. They hold this big press conference where they say they believe that Brittanie had traveled to the area where her cell phone last pinged, and she was killed there. So the FBI had received new information in this case, which had caused them to come to this conclusion. A man named Daquan Brown, who was a convicted felon doing time for manslaughter, told the FBI that back in 2009, he was at this stash house in McClellanville, where Brittanie's phone happened to ping. He said that he had to give money to a man named Sean Taylor, and while he was there, Sean's son, who was 16 at the time, named Timothy DeShawn, sexually assaulted a teenage girl who had a black eye. This was all going down in a room full of other men who were just watching, and he claimed that this girl was Brittanie Drexel. Timothy had reportedly snatched Brittanie kind of into like a trafficking situation, had taken her to the stash house and was offering her around to his friends. He was basically selling her against her will. Daquan said this all happened days after Brittanie vanished from Myrtle Beach. And he also claims that he saw Brittanie try to escape, but she was caught and taken back to the house where she was pistol whipped. He then heard gunshots after Brittanie was taken into another room, and he assumed that she had been shot to death. An FBI agent said that several witnesses told them that Brittanie's body was then taken and thrown into an alligator pit. Now, by the time all of this came out, Timothy was already in jail. He had been the getaway driver for an armed robbery. He was given probation for being the getaway driver, but then in 2016, he was arrested on federal charges related to the same crime. And they said they were going to throw the book at him unless he gave them information about Brittanie Drexel. Timothy claimed that he had nothing to do with Brittanie's disappearance, and he had never met her. arrested and charged with trying to kidnap a teen from the same area where Brittanie went missing. Sean's brother was also arrested and charged in 2001 in connection with the disappearance of a 19-year-old Shannon McConney. She was found dead and she was dumped in the woods in McClellanville. Now the charges against Sean and his brother were both dismissed because they didn't have enough evidence. But there does seem to be a family pattern here. However, without any solid evidence, they couldn't charge anyone in Brittanie's disappearance. Her case is still open. She is still considered a missing person to this day, although she is presumed dead. While there have been many different leads that seemed promising, nothing has panned out. There have been no arrests, and it's kind of hard to take one felon's word about a fellow felon. If you have any information about the disappearance of Brittanie Drexel, please call the Center for Missing and Exploited Children at 1-800-THE-LOST. I don't know. There's really not a ton of evidence that makes me think this person for sure was involved, although this family with all of these histories with kidnapping, attempted kidnapping, and murder, even though the charges were later dropped, it really does seem like there is a pattern in this family who all happen to be from McClellanville, where Brittanie's phone last pinged. Let me know what you guys think about this case. Thank you guys so much for joining me. Please make sure to check out the Summer Cell at Ana Luisa. The link is in the description.